I suspect that for some time to come, when I sing lines that I had not thought of that way before, you will see me cry. And when in scenes of glory, I sing the new song. Sorry. Gives me some excitement and some hope for the future. It's always a joy and a delight to have missionaries with us, and how we praise God for the work of Paul and Cheryl. And as you know, he's a man after my own heart, with all these lovely children, and another one on the way. Paul, I pray that God will bless you and your family. A tremendous ministry to have, whereby you have opportunity to set the example for many, many others and not merely talk about it. And so, without further ado, a good friend and brother, Paul Durand.
Good morning. We did stand out a little bit like a sore thumb in Chile, as nowadays there are not that many big families. But we praise the Lord for his blessings. Please turn with me to Colossians chapter 3. And in the meantime, I'll say it's a blessing to be with you again, see some of you that we haven't seen in quite a while, to be here in my home church. Colossians chapter 3, verse 17. Let us hear the Lord's word. Colossians 3, we'll read verse 17 and then I'll skip down to verse 23. And whatsoever ye do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. Verse 23. And whatsoever ye do, do it heartily, as to the Lord, and not unto men, knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Christ. Let us pray again. Father, we look to thee. We depend upon thee. We thank thee that, lo, you are with us always. As you have saved us, you never leave us, you shall never leave us nor forsake us. And Father, you are doing the work in us, and through your holy word. We pray, Lord, that you would bless the heavenly manna, not only to us, but as it falls throughout this earth today. Lord, that thy spirit would build thy church, edify thy people, focus our attention on Christ. We thank you for his precious words and all your holy testimony that we have in the Holy Scriptures. And we ask that this feast might be laid out for each one present here and within the sound of my voice, that this feast would be laid out by the Holy Spirit and you would turn us from sin and draw us nearer to Christ. Nearer to thee, O God, and that indeed we would be more than ever determined to present our lives a holy and living sacrifice unto thee, our Savior. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I'd like to speak about the call to repentance and service. So I more or less equate, although we could think of the call to service as more for Christians who have already begun our repentance. Yet God has given his holy law. It actually was given to Adam. And then as God walked with men like Abraham, they knew his will. They were guilty of sin. They suffered death as a result. But then it was laid down by Moses, as God revealed it to him in the Ten Commandments, and we have that summary of the holy law of God. Then Jesus, our Lord and Savior, gave us the two great commandments, pulling them out of the Old Testament, the law of Moses, and pointing out how they were a summary of the ten, to love God with all our heart, strength, soul, and mind, and to love our neighbors ourselves. Well, this is the law of God. And for us, as Christians, once we repent and we have faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, we know that He has, in His law and in His word, revealed and expounded His will for us in His law. This is how He would have us to show our love for Him, to show our gratefulness for Jesus laying down His life for me on the cross. Like we told the prisoners when we were down in South Carolina, entering into the prison more frequently, weekly, we would often say before them, you know, it's not enough, and I like to say this from time to time, it's not sufficient to think and say Jesus Christ died for the whole world or died for us. We need to personalize it. We need to realize Jesus Christ died for me. He died there on the cross so that I could have life by God's grace. And therefore, I will die for Him. I will live for Him. I will serve Him. And there are no super Christians that are the ones that serve Him as opposed to those that don't serve Him. All of us as Christians serve Him. Even the thief on the cross, who had but very little time to manifest his repentance, he rebuked the other thief on the other side of Jesus. He bore testimony before all these people to the crucified Savior that he had done no wrong. No, there's only Christians, and every one of us love the Lord because God has opened our eyes and shown us the Savior, and we have received Him as our Savior. We love Him, and we now serve Him. And so we want to obey the law. It's our shame. It's our torture, in a way, as Christians, when the Holy Spirit has converted, regenerated our heart, to think of the sin that we sin. And as we learn more, I think oftentimes how God, in His great mercy, you know, when we're converted, when we're first little baby Christians, He doesn't show us all our sin. If He showed us how much sin there was in our life, we'd be overcome. We probably wouldn't be able to do anything. But bit by bit, as we grow as Christians and we read the Word, we see more of our sin. We confess it, and we're to continue that repentance through our life, which is seeking to serve God better, seeking Him to be more faithful, seeking to love Him and obey His commandments. He says, if ye love me, what? Jesus said, obey my commandments. That's His will. And there's none of us that are Christians, truly, that do not love Him. We can't be Christians and not love Jesus. Well, there's a call to the ministry of the gospel of Christ, which is not for everyone. As I said a minute ago, there's a call to service, which is for everyone, but there's also a call to the ministry of the gospel of Christ, and perhaps there's one of you here. I know there's some that are already in the ministry with me, Pastor Spencer, Pastor Coleman, and some of you perhaps are elders serving the Lord in that way. But there is a special call to the ministry of the gospel. Perhaps one of you that has not yet become a minister may have that calling upon your life. But it is not for everyone. And what I'd like to do here is briefly consider each of these calls. The call is to everyone, right? Even to the unbeliever. Repent and serve God. Repent and believe the gospel and follow Jesus Christ and obey His word before it's everlastingly too late. Now they can't. We know they can't. Until the Holy Spirit does the work and opens their eyes and gives them faith in Jesus Christ. But still, that's the call. The law of God is to all the world. And woe be to him that doesn't have Christ as his Savior. First, though, before we briefly, as I said, it'll be brief when we consider these two calls, But first, I want to correct a few things which are frequently misunderstood, and we find this on the mission field too. When we are going to plant something, right, in a garden or in a field, it's necessary to prepare the land. We're not going to get very far if it's not broken up so that the water and the nutrients can get to the seeds and to the plant. So the land has to be plowed. And we know if the seed lands on top, you know, some could grow that way, but if it's hard soil and just lands on top, doesn't go inside, you know, then there's a problem. It could be dried by the sun or whatever. It's necessary to prepare the land. And when we're going to build, it's frequently necessary to remove that which is in the way. I said in the Sunday school lesson on Providence, how we ended up in three building projects. We have to clear out the brambles. You have to clear out the construction sometimes that maybe is an unwanted building. And therefore, that needs to be taken away before the other skyscraper or whatever it might be, church building, could be built there. And so it's frequently necessary to remove that which is in the way, maybe a forest or several trees, brambles and briars, or another construction. So that's what we're doing here with these first two points. First, service is not optional. It is part of being a Christian. It is a result of being born of the Holy Spirit. When we're born of God, we now love Him and we want to serve Him. Just as all of you who are Christians are serving Him. You're even serving Him by being here. You're serving Him by worshiping Him. You're serving Him by listening to His Word and giving the attention that His Word deserves, because the Bible is God's Word, the Word of your Creator and my Creator and our Savior. And so we love Him, we want to hear His Word expounded and applied, believe it and obey it, as much as the Holy Spirit gives us grace to be holy and to obey His Word, put it into practice. Woe unto us if we don't. You know, as James said, be ye doers of the Word and not hearers only. Obedience is required, and it is a fruit. That's one of the wonderful things about the Christian faith. Christianity is that every virtue, everything that's required of us, is also a grace. God doesn't, in this life, give us the ability to be perfect and perfectly obey His law. His law is exceedingly broad. But we do start to obey, and we grow as Christians in maturity to deny ourselves, take up our cross, daily walk after Jesus, apply His Word in our life, and be obedient and be a testimony to our neighbors and friends and acquaintances and maybe on the internet and in so many different ways. So obedience is a fruit as well. God requires it, but we obey as His Holy Spirit gives us the power, the faith, the growth, and the obedience to put His Word into practice and learn to love, because what God does is He loves through us, right? That's His commandment, is to love Him and love our neighbor, and God fills us and teaches us to love. God is love. He's many other things too, but that is one of His things, one of what He is. And you know, sadly, isn't it sad to think about the whole unregenerate world and all the unbelievers? They don't know how to love. That's what Christianity is all about. One of the things that it's all about is having God, who is love, live within us and teach us how to obey His Word. And as we obey His Word, we become like Christ, living like Christ in this world and loving others as He did to some degree. Well, let's consider just a moment this parable we read in Luke chapter 19. Tremendous parable that He gives, but especially these two verses. Verse 14, where after He tells us about this prince who was going off and coming back to receive a kingdom for himself, and then he was going to come back, his citizens hated him, verse 14, and sent a message after him saying, we do not want this man to reign over us. We don't want him to be our king. We don't want him to have the rule over us. They were citizens of this country, but they rejected him. They didn't want him. Just like the Jews rejected Jesus. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But to as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. And verse 13 goes on to say, which were born of God. We're born of God. We believe on his name and we're saved. But the Jews rejected him. That was about to happen. This is Luke 19. And pretty soon, if you keep reading Luke, you're going to get to the crucifixion of Christ, right? The rejection of our Lord and Savior, which in God's providence was necessary for our salvation, and part of his plan. But then look down at verse 27. After this prince receives the documents, receives the certification or whatever he needed, he comes back. And what happened to those that did not want him to reign over them, him to be their ruler? Read, but those mine enemies, says this new king. Jesus putting the words in his mouth. But those mine enemies, which would not, did not want that I should reign over them, bring hither and slay them before me. Verse 11 tells us that it gives us a reason for why he gave this parable. He was near Jerusalem. He was soon to be crucified and rejected. And they thought, doesn't tell us exactly who they are, but his listeners, right? A lot of them thought that the kingdom of God should immediately appear. It was not going to be everything changed all at once. Yeah, you know, a lot of things changed with Jesus' death, crucifixion, resurrection, and ascension, and the Holy Spirit coming down upon all flesh. Lots of things changed, but there was going to be a day yet, very much future. Here we are in the year 2014, and we're still awaiting his return. His return. And so he was giving them a message about, you know, somewhat related to himself and how he was going to go and come back. And then would come the judgment day. Christ is Lord and King. Very appropriately, in the providence of the Lord, we read Psalm 24. He is the King of glory. He's the King of kings and Lord of lords. And he said in Luke 6:46 to his hearers, why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things that I say? Can you imagine the... Of course, he was not in any way, he did not sin in any way. But here he was, the King of kings, the heir to the throne of all the universe, the Creator himself. And yet, people that would not obey him all over the place. Why do you call me Lord, Lord? And they even called him Lord, Lord. It's not enough to say that he's our Lord, that he's our King, or to profess to be a believer. We have to be regenerated in the heart, and then we begin to do the things which I say. But even us as Christians who are regenerated and have begun to do Christians to do his will, and take this applying it to ourselves, right? We still don't perfectly obey him. Why? Why do we call him Lord, Lord, and we don't do everything that he says and commands perfectly? It's because of the sin nature that still abides in us. But Jesus died to sanctify us, to save us, to renew us, to make us like himself, and we go through that process of sanctification in the Christian life. Praise God. Well, I want to point out to you before we leave this, that Jesus is King. Jesus is King. And unfortunately, in this day and age, we're not so used to kings. Maybe we're seeing a little more of it with the White House as it is, but still, it's not like in the old days when Jesus was on earth and there were kings everywhere and they had absolute authority and they could say, this man's going to die, and they would die pretty quick at the executioner's hand. I mean, I recently read the story of Herod the Great, when he made that ridiculous promise, and then he kept his promise and delivered the head of John the Baptist on a silver platter to the daughter of Herodias. His word was immediately executed. And that's the absolute authority that people were used to in the old world with so many kings. that had absolute authority. That's what our Lord has. And that's what he's talking about when he says, all power in heaven and in earth is given unto me. He has absolute authority because he's the king. He's our prophet and our priest, but he's also our king. And we're not accustomed today to this type of power and authority that is absolute. Now, think of the world in this two ways. One way in which we could divide everybody in the world. The world consists of servants of Christ, right? At least people that profess to serve Christ. But also there are, within that group, those who are serving Christ truly because we love him now. We believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and he's our Lord and Savior. The church, the believers, and the rest of the world. The unbelievers who do not serve Christ, who are the citizens who hate him. They're represented in this parable by the citizens who hate Jesus. And whatever they may say, they may call him Lord, Lord, or they may say, oh, the Bible is a wonderful book. But if they aren't repentant and they don't believe the Bible is true, they don't believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, they're not saved, they are like these citizens who hate the Lord God. They hate Jesus Christ, and they do not want him to rule over us. So when we're a Christian, we want him to rule over us. We rejoice that we have a king that protects us and saves us and even lives within us and empowers us to obey his word and live his word out. But the world is full of people who are citizens of this world. We read in Psalm 24, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. He owns it all. And yet they don't want him to rule over them. That's what our neighbors are like in this world. They do not want him to rule over them. They'll be kind and cordial and maybe somewhat moral in a worldly way. But they do not want Jesus Christ to rule over them. And that's the big issue. Or one of the big issues. Service, repentance is not an option. God gives it. It's part of salvation. I like to say salvation is a package deal. When he gives us faith, he gives us repentance too. He gives us the whole thing. It's God's grace and his mercy to do that work by his Holy Spirit in us. But service is not optional. And those who do not serve Christ, if they do not repent before the day of judgment, will find themselves with the goats rather than the sheep. Now, to which think also for a moment, to which in this parable did he say, well, well, thou good servant? Of course, to the ones that used their talents, right? And what God had given them, they used in service to him. He gave 10 to the one that had done well with 10 talents and 5 to the one that had done well with 5 servants. We'll return to this in a minute, a few minutes, this parable. But the second thing I want to clear out or talk about is the call to service is to serve God, not some of the time, not on the Lord's Day for an hour, for example, or a couple hours. It's to serve God in everything we do, all the time, living for him and dying for him. Whether we're studying at school or baking in a shop or whatever it is that we're doing. We serve Jesus Christ. We serve God. And that is God's call, to live for him, to wake up and pray and read his word and serve him in everything we do. When we answer the telephone, or whatever it might be. In 1 Corinthians 10:31, which is one of the proof texts for the first catechism, what is the chief end of man? Anybody here know that? Man's chief end is to glorify God and enjoy him forever. Well, one of the proof texts is 1 Corinthians 10:31. Paul says, whether therefore ye eat or drink or whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God. It's not an option, that's a command. Every one of us is responsible as Christians to do all to the glory of God. And likewise we read in Colossians chapter 3, verse 17, whatsoever ye do, what does that cover? It covers everything, doesn't it? Whatsoever ye do in word or deed, when you're talking, when you're acting, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, serving Him, giving thanks to God. And verse 23, and whatsoever ye do, do it heartily as to the Lord. We're sweeping something. We're cleaning the house. We're painting the house. We're at work. We're at school. We're to do that as believers, serving Christ and for the glory of Christ and to honor our Savior. Not unto men, not as unto men, but as to the Lord. Verse 24 says, knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance. For ye what? For ye serve the Lord Christ. So he's writing to the Colossians, a group of believers, a church. They are serving the Lord Jesus Christ in whatever they do. At work. And in all things. Of course, we serve God as well when we gather together to worship and we care for one another as the church. Service to Christ, then. And I suggest, if you haven't already memorized Colossians 3:23, it's a very good memory verse. I urge you to work on memorizing it. The Lord will use it in your life, I believe. Service to Christ consists in fulfilling your duties. That's basically what it is. Fulfilling your duties before God, serving your family. When you serve your family, you're serving Christ. When you serve your husband, when you serve your wife, when you serve your neighbor, your fellow believers, and all people, in one way or another. Service to Christ is seeking to do a good job and to honor Christ in worship, participation in the life of the church, and faithfulness. We seek to have a good testimony ourselves, as well as a testimony, have a good testimony for our church in Collingswood or wherever it may be. We're part of the testimony of the church and the witness to the truth of God's word. We serve Christ by being a good brother in the Lord, a faithful friend or fellow Christian, having fellowship with and taking care of your Christian brethren. I want you to just quickly think with me. Try to make a mental list so we can apply this a little bit to our lives as we go along here. We did this in Chile, and the first time I gave this message was in a Sunday school class with some young people, and we tried to lead them in making a list of activities, got some answers from them. What could you imagine would be things that would be obviously service to Christ in one column? Then another column, things that could be service to Christ. This is just an exercise. It's not a perfect illustration, but think along these lines for a second. Service to Christ on one hand, even secular work, as we do it in service to Christ. If we do it as unto the Lord and not unto men, it is service to Christ. Studies, I mentioned already. If we do it because we want to learn something that we can then later on use to the glory of God. Work at home. My wife likes it when I say changing diapers. Even that's service to Christ, when we take care of the little ones, or the bigger ones, or whatever we do. Prayer, more obviously, right? Service to Christ. Bible reading, if you're doing it with the right spirit and want to be taught and learn, grow. If we present the gospel to somebody else, or we preach the word of God, being a friend to somebody, truly, you know, and for Christ's sake, and raising a child for Christ, all these things could go in that one column of service to Christ, that, or, you know, provided we're not doing them wrong, with wrong motives. They're in that column. Things that could be, it depends on how we use them. Let's put text messages, for example. Sending a text message. Well, it depends on what the content of that text message is, right? Could be good or bad. Could be serving Christ with that or not. Using the internet can be wonderfully used for the service of Christ. Or could be used for evil purposes and contrary to God's will and law. Physical exercise. Profiteth little, says the Apostle Paul. It does have some profit. But maybe we do it with the wrong motives. So it could be or not. Driving. Depending on where we're driving or how we drive. And then in the third column, not service to Christ, all sin would fall into that category, no? Being unkind, selfish, ungodly, untruthful is sin. and not service to Christ or not submitting to Him. The call to serve God is a call, I equate it with the call to repentance. We Christians are to repent, but then we're to continue repenting for the rest of our lives as well. The motive to this is love to God. As we mentioned a little while ago, we see Christ. We believe He died for me, so I love God because He first loved me. And He provided in the covenant of grace a wonderful Savior. So now I want to live for Him. I want to serve Him. That's the motive to serve God and to obey. Love to God leads us to obedience, a desire to glorify Him and to seek His glory among others. Excuse me. A desire that others would know Him and His goodness in such a way that they will also love Him and glorify Him. This is natural to us as a Christian. When we love God, we see how wonderful it is to be a Christian. We want others to know Him well. And so we work together as a team to send the gospel to India and to Africa and support missions and works in South America or wherever it may be, as well as here in the United States, which is so needy. We want others to also love Him and glorify Him. And so we want to have a good testimony. We want to proclaim His truth. Now, what are your interests? Think for a moment of yourself and your own interests. Maybe what you're good at. But ask yourself, too, do you love God? Do you love God? And none of us love Him perfectly. May God give us growth. But if you don't love God at all, you need salvation. You need to cast yourself before Jesus, before God, and ask Him to save you, to give you that faith in Christ, to give you His Spirit. Jesus said to His disciples, and to everyone He was talking to at that time, I think, but He was talking to His disciples, teaching them how to pray, and at the end He said in Luke 11:13, If ye then being evil know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask Him? He's teaching them to pray. We all need to pray. Ask Him for more of His Spirit. For Christians, we have the Spirit of God in us, but we ought to seek to be filled with the Spirit more continually. There are many calls of the world. I'm talking about the call of God to repentance and service. But the world calls us to entertainment. We live in an entertainment-based society that would just have us watching sports or playing sports all the time or shows and going to movies or whatever it might be to be entertained instead of serving. There's a call to pleasures. Many calls of the world to pleasures. Calls to power and prestige. What are the fruits of all these things? Sadness, depression, pain, damage, punishment, loss. Responding to the calls of the world have no comparison to responding to the call to serve Christ. The fruits of the Christian life, believing and repenting, are eternal communion with God, love, joy, peace in the Holy Ghost. There is no comparison with the fruits of the calls of the world and the fruits of the calls to love and serve Christ. In Luke 19, in the parable, there was a pound given to each of the servants. And they were told to occupy, to transact business, to negotiate, to do something, right? What has God given to you? What is your pound? What is your talent? What is your ability? Maybe you're really good with computers. Maybe you're really good at writing. Maybe you're really good at speaking or teaching or whatever it may be, different kinds of work and activities. Maybe you're a good friend. What are those talents that you can use for Him? God has given them to you to use for His glory and honor, and He wants to love through you. He wants to live through you. As the one hymn writer said, take my hands and let them be. Take my lips and let them serve you. Let me be consecrated to you. We're to give ourselves completely to Him. To be His hands and feet and and mouth. How can you use what he's given you for him? This call to service is for everyone. It's for all. This is the call of God to repentance, and one responds to this call when God gives saving faith. Faith brings them to a service of love towards Christ and God, imperfect but sincere, true, and in proportion to our growth, fervent, I believe. We seek and want to obey him according to his word, according to his revelation. Now there is briefly another call to the ministry of the gospel of Christ, which is not for everyone, which is special for some. I just want to briefly touch upon this, so hang in with me. But it's important for every one of us to know this. Sometimes you need to vote on calling someone to be an elder, a ruling elder perhaps. It is necessary that the essential function of the administration of the covenant of grace may be fulfilled by means of particularly the preaching of the Word of God. And the church needs pastors and missionaries who will learn and study. Dr. Gordon said to me long ago, you know, the greatest need of this world is trained ministers of the gospel. And you support us in continuing this work. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. It's not simply telling the story of the cross, either. It is presenting the whole counsel of God, which gives us a right understanding of the cross and salvation. And Paul says, and how shall they hear without a preacher? And Jesus said, pray ye therefore that the Lord, pray the Lord of the harvest, that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. God is the first one that sends. And this is the call that he gives to the ministry of the Word of God. He raises up ministers to work in that as a life calling, a life vocation. The minister or preacher is not of a superior class to other members of the body of Christ. They're not super Christians. We all serve Christ in our different callings. Everyone fulfills an important function, as Paul points out, as that of the eye and the hand and the foot. When we do the will of God, we're all working as the body of Christ together as a team for the glory of God. But just the same, the church of Christ needs pastors, and we need missionaries to send. It is well that we should sound forth this call as well, but with a perfect confidence in God that calls internally. In Jeremiah 3, the Lord said, and I will give you pastors according to mine heart, which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding. God's the one that gives pastors. Praise God. I praise God for your pastor. We were praying, and the Lord provided your pastor to be a servant here. God is the one that gives pastors according to his heart. Christ is our good shepherd, and he will provide pastors through this internal call. To close up, I want to just mention, as we seek to do everything to the glory of God, that's what I'm calling you to do, to repent and seek to do everything that you do to the glory of God, let's remember what we found what we see in the Great Commission as it's presented in John 20, where Jesus says, as the Father has sent me, so send I you. He then turned and he visibly represented, the Bible says he breathed onto them the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit comes from him. He pours out his Holy Spirit. The essential is the Holy Spirit. We need to always be looking to him, always be connected to the vine, always be meditating on the Word of God, and being connected to Christ. Then he can love through us and serve through us and enable us. Don't think you're going to go out of here and repent on your own and serve God better in everything you do without the Holy Spirit, without Christ. Without Christ, we can do nothing. But being Christians, connected to him through faith, he will enable us to do more and more to the glory of God. So to close, what then must we each of us do? Trust and repent. Pray to the Lord of the harvest that he may send forth laborers into his harvest. I believe, really, when it comes to missions, that's the most you can do. Sure, it's great to give. It's important to give. It's important to give yourself or your sons, your children. But the biggest thing you can do is pray. Secondly, Let us each present ourselves a living sacrifice to do His will, whatever it is. And the church will not lack for pastors or missionaries or servants or helpers or whatever. Present ourselves a living sacrifice to do His will, as Paul calls us to do. And then Christ shall send forth pastors after His own heart and laborers into His harvest as we obey His word, and we'll see the blessing of Christ. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your precious word, for this call. Thank You, Father, that we don't respond to it on our own, that we read in Your word that if we love You, it's because You first loved us. Thank You, Father, for this wonderful, undeserved love. Lord, Your grace, Your forgiveness of sins, Your privilege that You give to us, Lord, of being Your sons and daughters and being lower lights in this world, pointing to Jesus Christ. May each of us look to Him, Lord, this afternoon. May we meditate on our Savior who loved us and gave Himself for us, that we may now be crucified with Him and live for Thee, for Thy glory and honor, dear Father. Forgive us of our sins and pray for Your salvation, Your teaching in the heart. The young people here and every one of us, Lord, building us up in our most holy faith, we pray and thank You for Your grace in Jesus' holy name.